to our event. This event has precipitated a lot more interest than I know. There's somebody in the door. Then we anticipated, which is great. A lot of people are interested in language teaching and in poetry, and hopefully at this point we can bring these two together in a very productive and interesting way. Now, I do have an autograph sheet, so if you haven't signed it yet, I would request you do that. The motto for this semester at the Language Resource Center is really. So my name is Simon. I work as an educational technologist at the Language Resource Center. As you might have gathered, I like to communicate via email. You probably received a ton of email from me last semester. This semester will not be any different than that. I was thinking about a limerick to begin this, to kick this off, but I can't think of anyone on the spot, so I will take this time to until I do that, I would like to pass the baton over to y'all so that we can maybe officially begin this. Or to Mathieu, if you want to say. Okay.
Well, thank you all for coming. A lot of people. It's great. We're going to talk about the use of poetry. We're talking about poetry and then some suggestions of how to work with poetry in the classroom, like what's the pedagogy behind it, and why we should or could use it. And I'm going to start this presentation with one question that I'm not going to answer. But I want to just like have it out there, like, what is poetry, and who creates poetry? And so we get started with this idea of a poetry. And for that, I got a few examples of what I'm trying to see here. So we've been working with poetry for a long time. Do you want to read the original examples? No. And so this is Sappho's. It's a ancient poem, and I'm not gonna read each one, and I'm not gonna use my reading abilities with this, but I just wanna show some, try to answer what poetry is. So we have this visual of what a poem is that we have in our minds when we see it. We get this, Shakespeare in English, a sonnet, like most languages have their prediction of sonnets or not, or it's something similar. But we also have different types of poetry, like this one. And this is it's in Portuguese, 1945. It's called Concrete Poetry, and there were lots of schools of concrete poetry in many languages. Also, this. And this is actually a video poem. It's like online poetry. And let's see, how do I click on the video? Like, should it...
to show a video?
Yeah, like, it's an YouTube link. If you click on the image, you should go to YouTube. Like, or not.
Yeah. Oh!
It's magic.
Amazing what you do with technology these days.
I'm just going to play a couple seconds so you guys can just see what it is that we're talking about here.
I am not sure about the song.
Você esteja em Marte, Teodorado. Abra a janela e veja. Quasimodo, abraço de ambos os.
So just it's also poetry. So those are just a few examples of what I have, poetry, of what we're talking about. So, as I said, I'm not answering what poetry is, but it shows what it can be and what we can do with poetry. And to get into pedagogy, I'm going over to our colleague here. Yeah, and he's going to talk a little bit about the poetry.
Hi everyone. I'm a lecturer, brand new lecturer in the French department. I taught at the University of Virginia before, and I am so glad to see poetry lovers. That's what we're that's what we hear. So I don't know. I think I just want to show you some of the experiences I had in my classes, some ideas so that I can share. Any suggestions that you have, it has to be a debate, a conversation, really, that's what I want us to be doing. So, the first question was really intriguing, what is poetry? And that's true, we could have probably so many definitions, like Paul Valéry, it's an hesitation between sound and meaning. Okay, well, we could have another definition, it's a pure poetry with the facts to be astonished all the time. That would be the goal of poetry, astonishment. Well, we can find another definition, but all these definitions are right. But we have to understand that poetry evolves with time, and each culture, each period of time, will have a definition of poetry. So I don't think it's necessary to define it. Actually, we could probably kill it if we were trying to define it. Probably better to think about the fact that when I'm in my classroom, instead of saying, hey guys, let's do poetry, I would probably not say that because poetry is very scary for many students. And when you actually have to make a joke, it's not a good idea to say, hey, I'm going to make a joke right now. Probably do your joke first, right? So poetry would probably work the same way. Do your poetry, let it work, okay? You're not writing poetry. Poetry is like working by itself. It doesn't have to write, right? There, it will be eventually its own definition when you're writing it. Okay, so I think that's how it goes. What I wanted to say with that title is that we should try to demystify a little bit poetry. Just make it casual, make it like on a daily routine. It doesn't have to be a big thing. So if we just like play around with words, with sounds, with sentences in our classes, we don't have much time. We have programs, we have things to do. That's true. But if we can incorporate some of those structures, ideas, imagination, that would be great. So, that's what I want to try to do, this idea of exploring a new field and having some poetic activities in the classroom. So I want to start also by saying that some students usually argue that they don't like creative writing. It's not a lack of imagination, I don't think so. It's usually because there's a lack of practice or because there's a lack of interest. And how to be interested when you have no idea what's going on and what it is, right? Or what you can do with it. So that's the thing, is that when we offer in the classroom some ideas about poetry, how to work with poetry. Well, of course, we can show models, and this is good for memorization, to have text and everything. We'll talk about it a little bit after. But I'm talking about creating, writing poetry in the classroom here. Well, I think it's always a good idea to suggest several topics for several levels, but also in one classroom, that's what I try to do all the time, giving options with different subjects, okay? So just to give you a specific example, if we're working on professions, let's say we're in a classroom, this is a time where we're learning words about all the professions, firemen, lawyers, and everything. Okay, good. Well, I would probably give two subjects. One subject would be pure imagination. So I will give the example of Henri Michaud, a French author, who actually imagined imaginary professions. A storm pacifier, rain designer, fish fryer, whatever you want. And then you let them free to imagine their own professions. And they can just like play with the vocab they have and combining vocabs and just like creating words like that, new professions. But if that is too scary for some students who do not feel like creative writing like that. They don't feel like writing things like that. But maybe it's also good just to have something a little less ambitious or less creative, but still creative in a way. Saying, okay, well, let's take the job as a lawyer, doctor, or architect, okay? And from there, let's describe a challenging day in your career. You're a lawyer, something, it's just images, you start baby step, and then from there, we're opening up a little bit. It's not good to, I don't think it's good to actually shower them with creative writing when they don't feel like creating really a writing poetry straight away. So baby steps. I wanted also to say that some students in my classrooms do not necessarily like to work collectively on poetry, so it's also always interesting to give them options to work individually with a piece of paper or in a group. It's good if they can work together, even better. But maybe don't force them. That's great also to have them having the option to, you know, just write some verses, some lines, some sentences by themselves. Options are really good, because when poetry is forced, poetry doesn't like that, I think. Well, also, so I wanted to talk about this idea of memorization. Poetry is good to memorize things. It's true, like all of these rhymes, things like that. But it stimulates a lot of many debates about cultural aspects of the language you're learning. So that's great. Because it is short, usually, many texts, many poems are short. It's easy to study them in class, but what text to choose? Where to start? So we can find text just to study vocabulary, that's good. Haiku, for instance, would be a perfect, very short text. Okay. Imitation, let's say. Seasons, to study seasons, for example, that's perfect. But you could also try, and sometimes for intermediate levels, having more political or social issues inside a poem. That's a good idea. It's not just about fallen leaves, right? You can also go a little further and have more political issues, immigration, unemployment, discrimination. You can find all of these things in some poems. And you also have some already, to stimulate imagination, some a mix of text and images, right? Calligraphs, for instance, the living objects of poetry, show that we can play around with those objects. We can start poetry from the very beginner's level. It doesn't have to be, we don't need to wait for advanced levels to do poetry. Just when you study furniture, for instance, furniture, this is beginners, level one. You can already think about an object like Francis Poulenc did, French poet, and take one object and try to see it from different angles, metamorphosis, or think about it as an animal or something, comparing metaphors, things like that. Great, we do play around. It's really important that students understand that poetry, first of all, touches pleasure. There has to be pleasure and fun in a way. Not only fun, but starting with fun could be good. And then we can go to something a little more interesting than just fun. Poetry workshop. That's what I do. I offer a poetry workshop also, besides what I do in the classroom. And I think it's interesting to have these things going on. It doesn't take much time. I do 3 poetry workshops per semester. Only 3. It takes me, 1 hour, 2 hours for one workshop. And in terms of preparation, yes, you have some things to do, of course, but it doesn't take much time. And when you can actually wake up students and show them that they can create a community outside of class, that's perfect, because then they can learn the language even better and find some common interest also. Create a community outside of class. I like that idea. So I called my workshop L'Heure Bleue, the Blue Hour. And I called it like that because I didn't want to answer the question, what is poetry? Because it's too hard. So instead of what is poetry, I asked the students, where is poetry? Moving a little bit the question, it's a little easier to answer that. If I ask you where or when is poetry, well, maybe we can have starting to have some answers, at least, or imagine more. So that's something I wanted to do. I think what I'd like to do for the next poetry workshop that I'm going to do, we've done several activities, I'll talk quickly about that, but what I want to do for the next one, I want to ask them to write what poetry is not, something which would be against poetry, that would be interesting also. It's pretty hard to imagine something which is not poetry. But I mean, that's something we can do. Okay, fast. I'm a little faster on other things. Mistakes. It's very important for the students to understand that mistakes are great. You can do things with mistakes. Okay, you shouldn't be scared of making mistakes, of butchering the language, as they say. I'm butchering English so much. Anyway, so this is fine for them to understand that mistakes can be tools to develop your imagination. However, not all mistakes like that. We need to understand that we have different kind of activities for those mistakes. I wouldn't work with the same pointing activities for beginners and intermediate necessarily in terms of levels. Beginners need, like babies, they need to actually have structures. If we play around with mistakes at first, it's too hard to learn the language. So for beginners level, I would go with themes, perspective, imagination, but the grammar will be steady. I'm not going to play with grammar too much. For intermediate levels, or maybe more advanced levels, yes, that's the time when you can actually break the rules. Tell them to break the rules. They know the rules already, so we can play around with that. And that's another way. So maybe adapt also these kind of things. And poetry develops critical thinking. It's another aspect which is very important. If you write a poem about a tree or a flower, for instance, that's great. You can learn vocabulary of, but you can also realize that it is linked necessarily with political topics or ecology as well. And from there, you can talk about how it creates debate. So, really. The idea of poetry that stimulates awareness and a sense of observation towards the language itself and towards the world we live in is very, I mean, it's paramount for me. Two more ideas, and before I stop a little bit. Poetry can help healing. That's really important. Students are stressed out. So, yeah, I've seen a lot of students like panicking. Poetry is an amazing tool to make them talk about themselves in a way they couldn't necessarily do. I had that one student at UVA, University of Virginia. He was not doing great in class. Many family issues, many problems, and I was just like challenging him with one poem, saying, hey, let's try. Mm-hmm. He wrote. The poem itself was not amazing, but what happened after was great. Thanks to the poem, he was able to open up a little bit. He trusted me more, he wrote more, he wanted to write more, and we created kind of a bond here where he could actually express himself. He felt better. His grades were not amazing, but he did better, and I like that. That's the healing part of a good way to channel all those feelings that a student might have. Last point that I want to talk about is the elasticity of the language of poetry. Poetry can really be a great way to explore different kind of interest in other fields through poetry. Biology, physics, politics. Because the students' attention isn't necessarily on the process of learning a language, but on using it to say something that is meaningful to them, students develop their curiosity, and this idea of curiosity is essential. So, to conclude, I'm just going to give you really random ideas about concretely what kind of activity I've done so far, which worked. So, one, of course, you probably have some idea of that, surrealist games, exquisite cadavers, you know, when you play with noun, adjectives, verbs, each person, each student will pick one noun, one verb, one adjective, and we'll put that together. They don't know what they're going to pick, and when we put it together, then you have a sentence, and we'll try to make this sentence work or understand what's going on with it. That's a great way to work on conjugation, agreements, and things like that, if there is such a thing in your language, for instance. Bus trip. We don't have much time, but if you do, if you want to, that worked very well for me. I took my classes to a bus, which is a random local bus, and I told them, okay, well, we're just going to go for probably 8 or 9 stations, and for those 8 or 9 stations, you write everything that you see around you. Spontaneous mind, beat generation, same thing, write what you have, give it up. And it was, which way, it was pretty successful. Give the students no more than 2 minutes to write a letter to their pen or to themselves. You fall in love with yourself, you fall in love with a chair. Write a love letter to the chair or to the mirror, whatever you want. This idea of love letter is pretty successful, usually. Well, it's fine. I have a lot of things to do. Describe a dinner from a point of view of a fly. The reactions of human beings, what do they do? So just moving, changing the angle is always a great way to work. One thing I did was, they were a little impressed with that, but it didn't go well. I wrote on the board as a composition that they had to do, red, question mark, and I told them, focus on the question mark, write something, anything you have connected to that color. Could be political, could be biological, could be anything you want. Red, question mark, you go on. Stimulating the students with those kind of things and let them free to write about what they like, and the color is very easy for that. It's perfect, I think it's great. I'm not going to develop much more than speaking about that. Thank you so much, and let's see what's going on.
There are, we have like a lot of activities, and a lot of us, we've been working poetry before. I'm going to go over a couple of ideas, and then more people are going to come and join us, I think, later. Ask Vine maybe later talk about her project, poetry, if you can. Not now, or when we'll open for questions if you're ready. And I'm going to show some activities here. What I have here is just my work here. I'm based on mainly four authors. Violence Colleague, Augusto Boal, Jean-Claude Bonitali, and Lucy Calkins. There are four known authors. Violence Colleague, she is responsible for the Encounter Theater in the 1960s in Chicago, New York. And she developed an improvisation for the theater, and her activities ended up being used a lot in the 70s and 80s and until today for classes, language classes, foreign language classes. So she basically works with improvisation for the theater and improv techniques. How are we going to fit this into poetry? I'm going to show you later. Augusto Boal is a Brazilian theater director. In the 70s, he developed what he called the theater of the repressed. He traveled all over Latin America, worked with theater techniques for the oppressed, and worked with the working class, with in factories, in villages in Latin America. And his work has also spread all over the world with the theater techniques and writing and politics. Jean-Claude Bonitali, he's a Belgian American. Playwright, and he wrote a book called Activities for Playwriting. But his activities for writing are actually very good for writing in general for the class, like the way he proposes writing. And it's why I'm fascinated by him a bit. And he does not believe in writing as a lonely activity. He believes in writing as a collective activity. And as a writer himself, he likes to share. Like, the collective is in many ways he talks about. And Lucy Calkins, she wrote a writing workshop, mainly for children, the writing techniques for children. But I think her, especially the idea of the workshop, the writing workshop is what is interesting for us as foreign language instructors in working in class. So let's see some activities and what we can do. So this is, I'm not gonna go over, but it's for everybody. It's some tips of work with poetry from two different books. And it's actually from the No-Nonsense Guide to Teaching Writing. And I think it's like crafting, and it's like writing, reading aloud. So helping students read aloud what they're writing, especially for foreign language, is interesting. In terms of poetry, when we're writing poetry and we have something ready, let's play with the words, breaking the lines, dividing again, putting it back. So we know that the poetry is actually has movement. Like we can move it around when we're writing. Play with sounds, as I said, like the idea of sounds, that's very important. And it's important for poetry, it's important for us as foreign language learners. And for poetry, it's, I'm just going to repeat this, the idea of fun and the idea of try to break the norm, try to be outside the norm and see what we can do with our language in class, and let the students also experience with language, with sounds, with pronunciation, with putting words together, how this works. Like, it's not necessarily a fixed idea, or so let's play around with what we have here. This could go from elementary to advanced. What I use a lot in my classes is I do a writer's journal. So the students keep a journal and where they write weekly, daily, and then it's like each instructor decides how they're going to do it. And we share the journal, we write together. And now, this semester, I'm trying to use OurSource and Canvas for the journal, so put it online. I'm not sure if I like it because I this is what I usually do with my students. So they have their notebooks and they write weekly. So this, my classes, they just write. And this is intermediate level. So you might be asking, Sam, what level is this? This is intermediate level. And we're not, I'm not grading, I'm not looking for spelling or anything. This is a creative writer's journal. It's their writing. This is not to be, it's to be graded. But we share and we read because this is, and I'm taking this from Lucy Hawkins in the Age of the Writing Workshop. This is their bank of ideas. This is where you get ideas for writing later. So it's like the buzz. What do you see? What do you do? And for the elementary, I've used this with words or short sentences, but it's creative, open writing in the target language, and they keep it for the semester. This is another activity that we do with poetry, and it's reaction to poems or art. And I just like, this is Elizabeth Bishop reaction to a Cambrian painting. So she wrote a poem, looking at art, like a visit to a museum or a visit, or how do we react to art? Another example here is again, audience reactions to another painting. So we can find examples in classic poetry, modern poetry, or if not, we can just work with this. So how do we respond to other forms of art? So if you have a painting, if you have a performance, a video, a short clip, how do we respond? Elementary level, with words, with sounds, or to more elaborate texts. How do we, are we gonna make this into poetry? Or we can work the other way around. How do we respond to poetry? In image, in sounds. Sounds and poetry, and if this is a, this is my method, and I just, he's an Italian, he was an Italian modernist, and this is one of his, the Zantuntum, one of his poems. This is actually one of his poems, and how do we react to this? So, we can play in class, in groups, in pairs, they can listen to sounds and they can describe them, where, when, what are we listening to? Individual writing or collective writing. So we're reacting here again to our environment. In terms of sounds, and what I like a lot about sounds is because if you go back to modernism, and we have American and English examples, Italian, Portuguese, French, work with the sounds in poetry. The Fernando Pessoa, Portuguese poet, he wrote poems just describing the sounds of the big city. So all those parts are parts of poetry. And there, one might ask, but are we actually working with language? Yes, we are. Because I think what I do a lot in my classes is like animal sounds, how they're different in any language, and how we describe. Like the way English describes dog sound, it's totally different in Portuguese. So this actually works a lot. Because my students, when they're listening to a dog barking, they tend to write woof woof, that means nothing in Portuguese. So what is it I'm trying to say in Portuguese when a dog's barking? So what is the words that we're using here for a dog barking? That notion of sounds and how it changes culturally from country to country is just an amazing resource of language in our classes. This is it's a classic poetry activity in class. It's from the Pope, inward here. And it's word and sounds. So this is the poem by João Nemi Neto, and it talks about the sounds in the kitchen, right? And some activities that you can do with the students is actually they read the poem and they go home and they record the sounds from like the murmuring of the gas. So record the sounds from the poem. Students listen to the sounds in class and they can match the sounds with the reading. So we're here working with poetry in our classes. We're not necessarily yet producing poetry. The students are not, but they are already reacting to the craft, to the idea of what poetry can do. Instructions. Instructions as poetry. This is very dear to me, instructions as poetry. I'm using here Yoko Ono, and before I say anything, just don't. Yoko Ono, she is one of the persons that I follow as a poet, as a person. So she wrote a book in 1963 called Instructions. And it's a book only instructions poetry. This is actually, well, we can't read it, but this is the wind piece, Blow Hats All Over the City. So her instructions are very 1960s, counterculture. So she, for languages like Portuguese, Spanish, or French, we have the notion of commands that we use a lot in our languages. This is amazing for class because you use instructions as poetry. Like this note piece, and I'm gonna go back to this note piece here. Like that she's like, listen, we're gonna get to listen to this note here. Music, image, and poetry. And we're gonna work a little bit here with this note piece that she wrote. Those are two images. And I'm gonna play just like 30 seconds of this song, please.
Can you tell me what?
This song has started.
And
counter reaction. The idea of listening to a song and then listening to another version in another language. I know we could have 5 workshops on the use of translation. Are we going to work the translation or not? It's very polemic or not. But it is a possible technique for working with foreign language as well. And then what I have here, it's invert the order of a poem here, and then we have an activity. Do we have time to play a little bit? Or?
4:45.
Okay, so I can show you later because we're running out of time here, but this is what I have here. Again, the poems here, I don't show to the students, but they have it here in slips and they put in order and then they read and compare the original version. I've heard before, maybe we should not do this where the stronger the poets work. Again, debate. So, to avoid that controversy, this is my piece of poetry, so you guys can play and do whatever you want. Really, cut it, not use it, just run it back, it's fine. So, but this is one activity that you can play. And then the students are actually creating original poetry. It is a new piece of poem here. Same words, but you can cut, you can play around with this. Some other activities. This is from one of our colleagues at the Spanish, she created a couple of activities, and I asked permission for her to use here the pictures that she has in her classes. Word bank, it's an activity that you have at nouns, positions, conjugated verbs, articles, and adjectives. The students work here, and then they create your home here with the words that they have there. The word bank, you can bring ready, or you can have the students also do the word bank in class. There are 2 different ways to do it.
There's also, at least in English, it's called poetic magnets, and each word is a magnet.
Yes, exactly. This is 11, it's like a form of 11 words. Pretty simple, like here. Like, this is like 1 word here, 2 words here, 3 words, 4 and 1. That you can change, and this could go for like elementary to all levels or a specific vocabulary. Here, language activities. Again, adding a sentence. Each person writes a sentence that she rotates in class, read the final version together. Sounds and sentences. I come back to sounds. We play sounds. What do you hear? What is this sound? What does it represent? And there's one activity that I do with the students, it's with songs. With each student starts with a piece of paper, and I have it here too. And I play one song, and they write something responding to the sound. And then I go changing. I go from classic to heavy metal, so the writing was represent what kind of song you hear. So it could also work for creative writing. Poetry from personal experience. This is from a meaningful literacy, writing poetry in the language classroom. This is a more advanced activity, and this is an adaptation for elementary levels that you can talk about your personal experience. Think about the moments of your life, your hometown, or something, a specific time or a holiday. List of words that describe the place, nouns, verbs, and adjectives, or short sentences. For the advanced level, this is like a little bit more, like, again, think of moments of your life, write a little bit more in depth about it. Make a collection of significant moments. So what is it you're telling the world? What is it like you? So all those ideas of talking and expressing a personal point of view or a moment in your life in the classroom. And use the technology in poetry. I mean, we have to talk about technology, I guess. So one of the things that we use a lot is Twitter. In Portuguese, there's what we call Tweet and Aptura, which is literature, which is a group of poets that are doing poetry in Twitter. So if you use the hashtag Twitter, you're going to find a group of poets only using Twitter for poetry. 2 years ago, they made a big exhibition in São Paulo, where I come from, at a museum, using Twitter technology and poetry. 48 poets got together, and the museum invited the 48 poets to present their poetry using Twitter. So this is really interesting, because you create the hashtag, students read each other's, and there's also what we call in Portuguese microcons, they're short stories, and that has become a crazy fad in Brazil, like short stories in the limit of Twitter. So you write like two-line short story, and it's really impressive what we read online with this. So it's like the micro poesia, like a short poetry. And this could all be in our classes. Okay. So those are a few activities that we have, and there's so many more. So anyways, I'm just here to show some things that we've been doing. I know there are a lot of people that does things different. Like I know that Mighty Dutch, she has done an amazing poetry project too. And in French, in Italian, and her different projects. So those are some ideas, suggestions. And before we finish, I just want to give my word to Szymon, and we're going to talk about.
Oh, okay. I'm ready to do this. I was thinking that maybe before I get out there and start boring you again, if there are any questions about this wonderful presentation, ideas, materials, this would be the time to pose them.
We need a second session.
We need a second session.
Yeah. What is one
today?
No.
I'm not ready for this commitment.
I have to get together and do like something like a hands-on workshop with the poet. Like I brought the activities. We don't have time, but I can show you the activities. I can show you. I have some handouts that I did the handouts in English, so you guys can take home some of the activities that I do. As a foreign language learner myself, so you guys can use my language learning in English as my handouts, as like thinking of poetry. And the poem that I did here, it's actually mine, because I wrote in Portuguese, and then last year I performed some of the poetry here, I believe some of you guys were there, and some students translated to English my poems, and we had like a collective writing and reading in Portuguese and English and other language students, one read one of my poems. So I know it sounds easier to me because I write my poetry so students can play around. This was not a class activity. These students were interested in enjoying the performance, and the translation actually now is going to be published. So they were not expecting it. It just happened. I was not expecting it either, but there are, I have here some, and the books are here too, if you guys want to take a look at the books that I mentioned.
I follow-up session would be great, because these ideas are great, but if we actually had a follow-up session where we actually did this as students, that would make us, some of us who are not as adept as working with poetry, maybe having a hands-on experience would really help for us to later put ourselves in the place of the suits and bring that to our class.
Mm-hmm.
So
oh,
I need that suggestion based on what
you guys want to do in Portuguese. Yes, I'm up for it. If you guys want to do it, I can totally do it, and we can create more activities. Yes, sure.
We should have a room in our schedule for that, I think. And on a Friday, that time seems to be working for everyone. Okay, so I'm taking over. Hello again. Yes, there. You may or may not know that there is a poetry festival that we are trying to cobble together. It is coming along better than expected. Some of you might have heard about that. For those of you who have not, we do have a name for this thing now. The name is Poesio. I don't. It's in Esperanto. I don't know if this is how you pronounce it in that language, but we chose this name because Esperanto is not offered at Columbia, and it's sort of international, at least in principle. So we thought this would be.
Yeah, Western.
Oh, sorry.
Pigeon accents are fairly Western.
Yes, yeah, that is a good point. We should work on a Japanese transcription of it. Anyway, this. And you know, our struggle with the title sort of exemplifies our challenge with this whole idea. We're trying to bring different language departments into a community event where we can exchange our experiences, but also learn something new that could enrich our language workshop abilities and also engage our students in this. So, to that end. Today we thought would be the official beginning of the sort of preparation, I suppose, for the festival. We wanted to give the community here a point of departure whereby you guys can start working on or thinking about how to incorporate poetry in your classes. It's very good that this turnout is so satisfying. There will be a follow-up. We will probably coordinate it and throw it some point later, maybe in the second half of the semester. But I'm just going to jump right into the timeline for this. This is the first time we're doing it, so everything is, it's not tentative, but there might be hiccups along the way. Between now and March 23rd, which you will notice is the Friday after spring break, you have essentially 2 months to work on these things in your classes. Then the submissions will be due from your students on March 23rd, and those will be from students to the departments. And then on a week after that, on March 30th, the departments will submit those works to us. How is this going to work? This is a really good question. We don't know how this is going to work, and we leave it up to you. So the whole selection process will happen within individual departments. All we ask is that from the department, from the language program, there is at most 5 poems that are submitted to us by March 30th, with the indication that the top 3 will be for reading for the contest.
All this information is on the second page of the handout we just made.
Yes, second question.
Sorry, can I ask a question about the language department and 5 submissions for a language department? Does it mean that for a department with like 5 languages?
I'm sorry, it's per language. Per language program. Okay. Yes, by language department, I mean
much fairer.
Yes, right. That's a very good point. Yeah, my.
I would never do that in a department where there are 2,000 sessions of Spanish and 5 of Portuguese.
That was important.
No, it's per language. Good point.
Thank you.
Okay, and then, so March 30th is when everything is due to us. On April 13th is when we hope to have the website going, and then the actual big event will be on April 20th. We do not know yet where it will be taking place. We are working very hard on that.
Can I just add something?
Yes, you
know, we're trying hopefully to create a tradition at the university. This is the first time we do it, and as much as we're expecting 54 languages participating, we know that it might not happen right now, so we are offering help, but we know that if it might be too much for some languages or some departments, and you guys can start trying out or something smaller. Right now, we're open for suggestions, and we're expecting a lot of people to participate. But we don't want to. It's not. We're not in hope. It's not in a position like it's not that the university is asking us to do it.
Right.
This is an initiative that we had. Hopefully, in my megalomaniac plan, in 3 years, all the ladies are going to be participating. But it might not be the case. We're going to let's see how we manage my expectations of reality. Sorry.
I don't even know if there might be languages here that I'm going to have 5 students.
Yeah.
So we'll see how that goes.
Yeah.
There's a point about selection of poems. Again, this will be decided within the program. João listed out some ideas that could be used to help select the finalists. And I think that's it.
Yeah.
The rest of it is pretty straightforward.
So, sorry, the agenda, so what we did is, here we present the project, and it's like dates and what we need. The second page, the first page would be the dates. The second page is a suggestion of activities and how to do it, like a timeline. So like first week, second week, third week, so you have something more specific. It's a suggestion. It might work for some languages, might not work for others, but this is what I was thinking could work, like I was thinking of us teaching Portuguese. So how we could work this, like week by week, it's like a more detailed for those who like need more structure, like me. And the third page, we just anticipated some questions that you might have about language, pronunciation, and then also like, I don't know, if you have any other questions, you could write us and ask questions, and we're trying, we're open for suggestions and see how this, but the second page is a suggestion of timeline. It might work for you, and it might not, and you can make any adaptations here that you think would work better for your own instruction and your colleagues in your department.
I noticed on the third page it talks about advanced category. So are you envisioning three tones, one from beginner, one from intermediate, one from advanced?
Oh, sure. If that's what you would like to do,
Suggesting
you're saying advanced category. Yeah, but what happens is, because we're not sure how each language is going to work, and because some languages have more or less students, yes, but we're also not saying yes for sure, because some languages might have two intermediate students participating, and then we're going to say yes. For now, we're going to accept it. So that's why the language is like, oh, yay, maybe, yeah. But yeah, the answer is yes,
everyone. Well, I thought the answer was yes, but not yes.
Yeah.
Anything else? Okay, well, if you do think of something, you can email me back. I do enjoy receiving emails from you. I read all of them, and sometimes even these ones. I will reply to them. The goal of this is to try to do something different, something that in my experience has never been done. João, I don't know if you've ever participated in anything like that. There seems to be an interest in this kind of thing, just judging by the turnout today. And we really hope it'll work, and we can start something cool. And on that note, thank you for participating.
Yeah.